Before 9/11, the worst terrorist attack on American soil happened in Oklahoma City. An anti-government radical parked a van laden with explosives outside the north entrance of a federal building and one floor below a daycare. Moments later, Kathy Sanders saw black smoke rising in the distance.
Kathy Sanders' memories of April 19, 1995 are vivid and painful. It was the day Terry Nichols and Timothy McVeigh bombed the Alfred P. Murrah Building in Oklahoma City. 168 people were killed, including her two grandsons, Chase and Colton. Consumed with bitterness and hatred, Kathy became depressed and even contemplated suicide. Then she realized there was only one way she could move on with her life. In her book, Now You See Me, Kathy tells how she found peace by forgiving the two men who caused her and many others so much pain.
Kathy Sanders is here with more. Kathy, thank you for being with us.
Thank you.
It's hard to believe 20 years ago on the 19th of this month, this all occurred.
Oh, absolutely it is.
It seems so much more present than that because it was so horrific. Talk a little bit about that day, April 19th. You and your daughter and her two sons were living with you at that time,
That's
right?
That's right, they were.
You had gone to work that day. The boys would go into this child care facility that was a part of the building that was blown up. When did you know that your boys, your grandsons, were going to be affected by this?
Oh, I knew immediately. Edie and I worked just a couple of blocks from the building, and when the bomb went off, we ran down there. And when we looked at the building there on the north side, it was nothing left but a pancake pile of rubble. Edie fell to her knees, my babies, my babies. Mm. And it was the first time in my daughter's life that she had a problem that her mother couldn't fix.
Yeah, you write about it so poignantly in the book. I mean, the terror that you felt as you were even running those blocks, hoping against hope that the boys were alive. You get there and you find out over a window of time that your grandsons have not survived. Really, no one survived in that area that they were in. We just heard in that story about the Holocaust how the woman in that story had a place where she lost her faith. Here you are, you know, your mother had died the year before, your grandsons are murdered in this way. Where was your faith at? What happened to you?
When I saw that casket lowered into the ground with my grandsons in it, my belief system was challenged. I had to wonder, where is that good and loving God that I had prayed to all my life? I had prayed for those little boys every day of their lives, and now they were gone. I'd see the surviving children's parents get on TV holding their child, and they'd say, you know, we just asked God for a little boy to hold, and God answered our prayer, and here he is. Well, we prayed and asked God for a little boy to hold, and we lost two of them. Mm. We had a hard time working through that. I've since come to the realization that God's not a cherry picker. The morning of the bombing, he didn't say, you know, I think I'll save this child, and this child, and I think I'll let these other children perish. It wasn't God that blew up the building. It was Timothy McVeigh. I came to a real realization in my life when I realized that God did not take my grandchildren. He simply received them when they came. Yeah. That brought me peace.
And another thing that brought you hope was a comment that John Walsh from America's Most Wanted made. I mean, he lost his son in a horrific abduction and then murder scenario. What was it that he said that kind of opened your heart up?
Well, up until the point I met John Walsh, I didn't know if I was going to survive. Mm. I wanted to die. I thought about committing suicide, but I couldn't do that to my daughter and my husband. I prayed to die, because I didn't want to live in a world filled with such pain. But John Walsh spoke to a group of us and he said, you will grieve and you will grieve deeply, but you will survive. Up to that point, I didn't know if I would because I hadn't seen a survivor.
Yeah.
I think that's why I'm so passionate today about sharing my story. I always love to have the opportunity to share my testimony and let people know just how far the Lord's worked in my life and that you can overcome.
And only someone like John Walsh, who had paid himself such a terrible price, could say those words and have them mean anything.
That's
really
exactly right.
You mentioned how God had changed your heart. There's so much we're skipping over in this story,
yes,
of what it was like for you, but I want to talk about what God did do in your life. You formed some unlikely friendships that really brought you some kickback from people who didn't understand it, but it all began with Joyce Wilt. Talk a little bit about your friendship with her.
Well, at the trials, I met Terry Nichols' mother, and I began to sit with her. I had a real love for her because I thought she'd been the forgotten victim of
Talk
the crime.
About isolated.
Yeah, the whole world had reached out to our family. Nobody was reaching out to hers. So we began to eat lunch together. We began to sit together in the courtroom. And it wasn't long. It was my first baby step in learning to forgive, because it wasn't long before Terry Nichols, the bomber, became my friend Joyce's son.
Wow.
And that began to change the way I viewed him.
So how did you go from meeting his mother and having compassion for her? I often feel that way about people who wind up in horrible court situations because their children or spouse did something awful. Now you began to actually write to Terry. What there was something in you that compelled you to make this connection.
Well, when the trial was over, Terry Nichols wrote me a letter. And when I went to the mailbox and opened that, it's like, oh man, I'm not looking for a pen pal. And if I was, it wouldn't be the Oklahoma City bomber.
Yeah.
And then I thought, something inside me told me to open it. And I wrote back, because at that time, I didn't really understand what was going on in my life.
Mm-hmm.
But I had still unanswered questions about the bombing.
And grief.
Yes, and grief. And I wanted to know, I had these questions about who the other people were that I believed were involved. And I thought, you know what, I'll write to Terry, and I can probably get my answers if I befriend him.
Mm-hmm.
But my writing, over a course of time, my heart began to change. I've learned that forgiveness is a process. It's not an event. You know, I read my Bible, and in the Lord's Prayer, it says, forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And it's like, Lord, how do you do that?
Yeah.
How do you do it? So I decided, well, maybe I should pray for Nichols and for McVeigh. And I did. I said, Lord, I lift Terry Nichols and Timothy McVeigh up to you. And then it was as if I'd hit a stone wall. I didn't know what else to say. So I said, Lord, you're going to have to send your Holy Spirit to intercede for me, because I don't know how to pray for these men.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know what my prayers did for Nichols or McVeigh, but I do know when I begin to pray for them, it began to change my life.
Wow. Wow. And it is a process. I think God just wants us to be willing to engage in that process. And he really does change our hearts and do something within us. Eventually, you started painting. That became a hobby and helped you work through some of your grief. What are you doing now?
Well, today I'm an artist by trade. I have a ministry I call Portraits of Love. I love to paint portraits for families that have lost children. I did the children that were killed in the Moore tornadoes a couple of years ago, and last year we lost some in Arkansas. And the reason I do that, I can't tell you how many children's funerals I've attended, but I offer the gift of a portrait in the hopes that allows me to get to know this family, and that I can be their John Walsh, that I can offer them the hope.
A legacy of hope, really.
Yes.
And
mm-hmm.
a legacy of hope and a memory of deep, deep love. Well, we have not had time to do much more than skim the surface. Kathy, thank you for sharing your story. If you want to read more, and you really should, get her book. It's called Now You See Me, which is available in stores nationwide. You can also look at some of her art by following a link on cbn.com, so be sure to visit there as well.